Good morning, everyone. I have your attention. Thank you for, wow, I am just delighted and thrilled. I'm Heather Caswell, owner and style curator here at The Wardrobe. And it is my sincere pleasure to see so many familiar faces and such a beautiful community here to honor Amy Goodman and Democracy Now! The Wardrobe, along with Davis Media Access and KDVS, are delighted to be bringing you this beautiful fundraiser for public radio. I'm just trying to get a few more people seated. Okay. All right, so some of you might wonder, what do fashion and politics and Democracy Now! Have in common? In 1987, I moved to Davis and asked myself, shortly after arriving and working at the Blue Mango restaurant, if I could do anything, thanks, if I could do anything, what would it be? And the answer was, be a DJ. So I proceeded down to Lower Freeborn Hall on KDVS 90.3 FM, and I became a DJ. And my show is called The Language of the Future. That is where I found my voice. 4 years ago, I volunteered at Davis Media Access and became a board member. And I started to pay it forward. And that's how we got here today. So I ask you to be inspired. Thank you. I ask you to be inspired by what we create here, and I ask you to make a difference, to donate generously to public radio, 90.3 and 95.7, make Davis, Davis.
And they're both having fundraisers coming up.
And they both have big, big fundraisers that I hope you'll contribute to. There's an opportunity to contribute after this. And again, it's my honor to be able to host this along with Davis Media Access this morning, and I am now going to bring you Autumn LeBay Renaud, the director of Davis Media Access. Thank you, Autumn.
Thank you. Good morning. We are anxiously awaiting the arrival of our speakers, so we're going to get this part out of the way. I'm really honored to be here, and I want to give my heartfelt thanks to Heather and The Wardrobe for saying yes. It's not every day that one of my personal heroes contacts me and says, we'd like to do an event for your organization in 3.5 weeks. The day after picnic day. Can you make that happen? So I reached out to my creative friend, Heather, and she said yes, and she and her staff have been wonderful. So thank you, Heather. And I'd like to thank each of you for coming. As Heather said, there's many familiar faces in the audience. I know many of you as longtime supporters of Davis Media Access, and I'm sure KDVS as well, and KDRT. And I'm gonna turn this over briefly to Aaron Frankel, who's the Public Affairs Director for KDVS. And then when Aaron's done, we'll see if our speakers are here and I'll introduce them.
Thank you, Autumn. I'm Aaron Frankel, Public Affairs Director at KDVS. As has been mentioned, we have a fundraiser coming up. It starts at midnight tonight. Please donate. We rely on donations from the community. It's what allows us to stay freeform. It allows us to stay independent. And in addition to music, KDVS, we also bring public affairs shows, you know, which address issues relevant to the community. I also just wanted to thank everybody who's worked hard to put this event together. I know it was definitely last minute. Autumn, Heather, I'm sure I'm leaving out a lot of people who've done lots of hard work to help us all be here and help get Amy Goodman to Davis so we can be in contact with the voice that we hear, some of us, every weekday on the radio. Thank you. And also, shout out to Olivia, our general manager. She's put in a lot of hard work. Thanks.
So again, I'm Autumn Labbé-Renault. I'm the executive director of Davis Media Access, and I'm beyond proud to have our guest here today with us. Thank you. I'm also celebrating 20 years in community media this year, and it is something that in Davis, we've had to fight for it. We've had to fend off funding cuts. We've had to fight signal encroachment for KDRT. We've done a lot of work to keep it alive and happening. However, we've never been beaten, arrested, or detained like our honorable guest here, thankful to say. But we do have in common just a bedrock commitment to the need for independent outlets, independent media outlets, and the need to hear a diversity of voices. I'm not going to spend a lot of time introducing our guest and all their accomplishments because hopefully you found that on your seats with the lovely handout. I'll just say that it's my honor to introduce Amy Goodman, David Goodman, and Denis Moynihan.
Well, this is a testament to the flexibility of independent media. We are doing things in a variety of venues, but a clothing store where, as Amy suggested, the urge to shop is competing hard with So I'll just say it's great to be here in Davis. I have a special affection for this place because my niece has attended here, worked here, and is now moving back to work in Davis. But I'll tell you that 20 years ago, my family was, Amy came to tell us about a new project that she was doing, an election show called Democracy Now! She told my parents, and they were initially thrilled because Amy, as you will read in this book and hear, had been dodging bullets in and out of police detaining her for trying to report the news. So when she told my parents that she had been asked to host an election show for the 1996 elections, they were thrilled because finally their daughter was going to have a boring desk job. She was going to report on the election. It was the re-election of Bill Clinton. He was running against Bob Dole and Ross Perot, if you remember that name, the Donald Trump before there was a Donald Trump. And, you know, it was going to be one of these who's hot, who's not, and it's all over the day after election day and we go home. Well, 20 years later, here we are. There is, in the beginning of the book, you'll read, it didn't quite work out to be a boring desk job. The independent reporter's rap sheet we felt compelled to include in the introduction to the book, where you can read about Amy's detention at the Republican National Convention, the arrest at covering a show where Plowshares activists were, an arrest in front of the White House with Terry Tempest Williams and Alice Walker and other writers. So really, we have, after 20 years here, Democracy Now! Is so much more than a news show. It is the place that tells you where you can go to know that you are not crazy, you're not wrong, and you're not alone. So I want to just say happy birthday to Democracy Now! And to my sister, once again, a tip of the hat to America's most fearless, courageous, and honest journalist.
So, do you have these in a size? Oh, excuse me.
It's very, very unusual.
Especially the tutu at the back. It's very good. But when we were coming into town, there was a foot race in, what was that community? Somewhere along the way. This is our 13th or 14th city. And a number of the runners were wearing tutus just like that, from 6 years old to adults. Yes? Not to worry. Well, thank you so much, Autumn. And it's wonderful to be here to support independent media, public access TV, and also a shout out to our colleagues at KDVS. Are there any students here who've been involved in the protests? You are? Very interesting. We're just learning about and reporting on in the last weeks what's been the organizing that's going on at Davis. But So this is our 11th, 12th, 13th city. We're going on to Chico this afternoon, and then this evening at 7:30, we'll be celebrating the first Pacifica station, KPFA in Berkeley. So, Friday was Pacifica's 67th birthday. It's our 20th anniversary. Autumn has also been here for 20 years, so the synchronicity is absolutely beautiful. I come originally from Pacifica Radio, which was founded on April 15th, 1949. It was founded by a war resister in World War II, a conscientious objector, who came out of the detention camps and said there has to be a media outlet not run by corporations that profit from war, but run by journalists and artists. And that's how Pacifica was born. The first Pacifica station, KPFA, in 49. 59, KPFK in Los Angeles. 60, my station in New York. That's WBAI, and in its first year, hosting a debate between Malcolm X and James Baldwin on the effectiveness of nonviolent civil disobedience, the lunch counter sit-ins of the South. 1970, KPFT went on the air in Houston. 1977, WPFW in Washington. That's the five Pacifica stations. KPFT is very interesting in the Petro Metro. That's in Houston, Texas. It went on the air in the spring of 1970, and within a few weeks, it was blown up. The transmitter was blown up by the Ku Klux Klan. They strapped dynamite to the base of it. It was right in the middle of Arlo Guthrie singing Alice's Restaurant. And I thought that was a good song. But I know people have, you know, very particular tastes. But so they get back on their feet. They rebuild the transmitter. You know, Pacifica doesn't have much money, and it's not as if they had money to pay for publicity for their station. Certainly, the silver lining was it exploded it into the consciousness of the potential listening audience of Houston. But I don't recommend this as an advertising strategy. They get back on their feet, and they go back on the air. And the Klan blows it up again, this time with 15 times the dynamite. Now it's becoming a national story. In the beginning of 1971, it took longer, but they rebuilt the transmitter. Public television came in to broadcast them going back on the air, and Arlo Guthrie came into Houston to finish his song live. Now, I can't remember if it was the Exalted Cyclops or the Grand Dragon, because I often confuse their titles. But he said it was his proudest act. I think that's because he understood how dangerous Pacifica is, how dangerous independent media is. Dangerous because it allows people to speak for themselves. And when you hear someone describing their own experience, whether it's a Palestinian child or an Israeli grandmother, whether it is an aunt in Afghanistan, an uncle in Iraq, it begins to challenge the stereotypes that fuel these hate groups. Because you're hearing someone describe their own experience. You might say, it sounds like my bubba, my baby, my aunt, my uncle, and I'm not saying you'll agree with them, right? How often do we agree with our family members even? But you begin to understand where they're coming from. And that understanding is the beginning of peace. I think the media can be the greatest force for peace on earth. Instead, all too often, it's wielded as a weapon of war, which is why we have to take it back. We have been on this amazing journey for 20 years. Democracy Now! Began in 1996 as the only daily election show in public broadcast, and we're on 9 community radio stations. The week of September 11, 2001, coincidentally, we went on our first TV station. Like Davis Public Access TV, it was Manhattan Neighborhood Network in New York City. They had asked if they could start broadcasting the show. They had a special link to the community media center we were broadcasting from. It was a 100-year-old firehouse now serving the community in a different way. We went on the air. We were the closest national broadcast to Ground Zero. And we became emergency programming, and stations all over the country started to ask, can we run you as well? And so the FedEx guys would come. I insisted it be delivered the next day because I thought it was breaking news. And they would leave with sacks full of video cassettes. That's when we had video cassettes, and the stations would get the next day. When we would go on a public access station, the local community station or NPR station would say, can we run you? And then the PBS station started saying, can we run you? So, you know, in San Francisco, we're on KQED and on KRCB PBS, and in Los Angeles on KLCS and on KCET. And that's how it works all over the country until it grew to 1,400 stations, the largest public media collaboration in the country. A station a week is picking us up somewhere in the world. We broadcast like every day, a number of times a day in Sweden on their open channels, as they call them, and on radio. In Japan, they call it the Other America. In South Africa, throughout Europe, we translate our headlines into Spanish. It is a great way, if you're learning Spanish or English, go to democracynow.org/espanol. And you can read our headlines, the very headlines we have in English. You could put them against each other. Or you can read the Spanish and listen to the audio, because any radio station can run the Spanish. We deeply believe in media without borders. I think of the media as a huge kitchen table that stretches across the globe, that we all sit around and debate and discuss the most important issues of the day. War and peace, life and death, and anything less than that is a disservice to the service men and women of this country. They can't have these debates on military bases. They rely on us in civilian society to have the discussions that lead to the decisions about whether they live or die, whether they're sent to kill or be killed. Anything less than that is a disservice to a democratic society. Now, you know, we cover movements, and movements make history. I want to talk about one year in this 20 years. And also, if anyone's tweeting or photographing or you're putting out stuff on Instagram or Facebook, use the hashtag covering the movements. And we're sending around daily digest sign-up lists to keep in touch with you, to send you our headlines every day and our news stories. So you can sign up for them. I know our co-author, Denis Moynihan, will be in with them in a minute. And we have fantastic volunteers who've come in from all over. But you can also, on your phone, you can text the word Democracy Now, one word, Democracy Now, to the number 66866. And you'll get a request for your email. You give it. You can confirm it in your email later, and you will get those headlines that way. It's how we have grown to be completely digitally engaged. From the beginning, we needed to use the internet. I mean, 20 years ago, because we didn't have the money for satellites to send our radio show and then TV, we perfected a way to send broadcast quality video through the internet. You know, the networks, they used millions of dollars they would give, for example, to Saddam Hussein to pay for his satellites. We didn't do that. We had our reporter, Jeremy Scahill, and many of you may know him from Blackwater and the latest film, Dirty Wars, the Oscar-nominated film. Jeremy, in Iraq, they were producing, he and Jackie Suin, amazing video reports for us. Saddam had put up a firewall. So they would go into an internet cafe, use a special program, send it like by 150 email to us, like through a screen, and then we would piece it back together in New York. And here is the wonderful Denis Moynihan, co-author of Democracy Now!, where you can sign up. And Denis, without Denis and David, David, a wonderful journalist based in Vermont, Denis, my co-author of a daily column in for Hearst, Hearst King's Features, and then also both of them co-authors of this book. This book would never, ever have been written. So a huge shout out to them. By the way, I think we're working with Avid Reader here. And it's wonderful to know there are independent bookstores here. Let's not take this... I don't take this for granted. We have been on book tours five other times with our previous books. And every time we come through, thousands of bookstores close. Independent bookstores are sanctuaries of dissent. It's a place you can take journeys through time, across continents. And so to be able to support them, as well as public access and community radio, all of these are oases. Now, if you haven't gotten a book yet, you can get a book from Avid Reader. We also just brought in a DVD. It's a special Democracy Now! DVD. Nermeen Sheikh and I did an interview with Glenn Greenwald, the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, just a few weeks ago. I mean, we've interviewed him many times. He lives in Brazil, but he had just come into Arizona because he was doing a special event with Noam Chomsky and Ed Snowden by, you know, video stream from Russia, where he's in political exile. And we talk a lot about Edward Snowden, Chelsea Manning, Julian Assange, who I go periodically to meet with in England in captivity. He's gotten political asylum in the Ecuadorian embassy there. You know, he is the co-founder of WikiLeaks, released millions of documents that have sparked a critical discussion, like Edward Snowden. What we don't know is done in our name. A discussion that even President Obama has acknowledged as critical. You know, they're trying to take down Edward Snowden, imprison him in the United States. But President Obama said, oh, this discussion would have happened without him. Really, who exactly would have prompted this discussion? Because the Obama administration denied everything he said until he actually had the documents and they could not deny it anymore. It also, by the way, encourages whistleblowers to release the documents, because if you don't, the administration denies it. And I say, you know, I'm not going to take your word for it until you have the documents, and then they have to back off. And why does it matter? Well, is it important to know that your government is spying on you, is engaged in comprehensive surveillance of American citizens? You may say, I think it's a good idea. You may say, I think it's a terrible idea. Well, we should debate it as American citizens and non-citizens and decide what kind of government we want to represent us, and what privacy means, and how do we move on as a civilized society. So we have a chapter on whistleblowers. If you get two copies of the book, you get the DVD for free. The DVD is more expensive than the book, but we are offering the special gift if you get two copies. And we're also trying to drive this book up the bestseller list of the New York Times. Why? They don't like to talk about Democracy Now! I mean, a lot of the media is amusing, in the corporate media and the networks. We've decided that one day Webster's will redefine exclusive as heard on Democracy Now! A year ago or a month ago. Look at New York Times today. Big story on the nuclear arsenal. An amazing story. And listen to our show at Stanford last week. There's been situations. I remember on MSNBC, we were watching one of the shows, and we had just done an interview with one of the major whistleblowers, and we had it exclusive, you know, top story. So 2 days later, they were interviewing this whistleblower, and I don't know if you know how TV works, but they pulled a clip for the billboard when the show first opens. And it was the whistleblower speaking, but they hadn't actually interviewed him yet. They were going to interview him in a few minutes, so where did they get that clip? And they put a lower third, that's what's at the bottom of the screen when it identifies the person. You can see Democracy Now!, the logo sticking out under it. They've blown it up a little so you don't see our Democracy Now! Backdrop. And he's talking, and on there, and by the way, that's okay. We use clips of CNN, Fox, and we tell you, you know, on Fox, this guy was interviewed last week, but they, on the lower third, they covered ours with the word exclusive. We just on the entry, and that would be coming up. I mean, it is bald-faced, it is, but we encourage it. We encourage the depravity. We deeply encourage people to steal this story, please.
This is why we do what we do, to go to where the silence is, to bring out the voices of people at the grassroots who represent the movements that have made history. To go to where the silence is. You know, often it's not really that silent, but it is in the corporate media. These are the movements that are shaping this country that barely hit the corporate media radar screen that we have been with from the beginning. I think the reason Democracy Now! Has grown so astronomically is because of the authenticity of the voices you hear. Going to the heart of a story, not to the pundits, but to the people themselves who are engaged in a particular action. You can agree with them or not agree with them, but you want to hear someone speaking for themselves so you can make up your own mind. I remember a few years ago, President Obama was speaking at National Defense University explaining the drone program, right, why they're expanding it. And Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, was protesting in the audience. She stood up and she said, "I love my country. Why did you kill Tariq Aziz, who is a teenager, not the Iraqi spokesperson, but a teenager in Pakistan who had just held a news conference. He was a kid talking about how drones were terrorizing his community. He'd gone back to the Northwest frontier to document what was happening. And 2 days later, he was killed in a drone strike." And she shouted, "What about Abdurrahman Alaki, the 16-year-old Denver-born U.S. citizen who was eviscerated in a drone strike in Yemen?" She said, "Why? Why don't you explain?" And as she's being dragged out, President Obama actually says, "You should listen to that woman," interestingly enough. Anyway, so I'm watching it on TV, like all of us in our newsroom, and oh, and then I get a call from one of the networks, "Would you like to come on to describe what she did?" I said, "I could. I mean, I watched it like all of you on television." I said, "You know, we're actually having Medea on the show tomorrow. Not that I wanted to give them our exclusive. I'd like her to be first on our show. But I said, you know, why don't you have her on? She gets jailed a lot, but I don't think she got actually arrested for this protest. You could probably have her on tonight." And they said, "You know, we can't do that." So I said, "What do you mean you know you can't do that? We're journalists. You go to where the people are, let them say what they have to say, have a debate about it if you want. What are you afraid of?" You know, how often all these networks bring us this small circle of pundits who know so little about so much, explaining the world to us and getting it so wrong. If you want to get two copies of the book, you get this DVD, about an hour and a half. It was Nermeen who was just texting me, saying, "Hi, Nermeen, talking about you right now." She's planning tomorrow's show. And we interviewed Glenn when he came here to the United States on every issue with Chomsky and Snowden. He was about to go be with them, but we talked about the what he calls a coup that's going on in Brazil right now. He talked about the surveillance society. He talked about war and peace. And all of this is on this DVD. So you can get that for $2, or get one book, or don't get any book at all. I'm so deeply appreciative that you're here, that you're supporting public access here in Davis. That is ultimately what's so important. But in terms of the politics of what it means to get on the bestseller list, aside from that, and we actually even named this book Democracy Now!, so they actually put the word on. That's just mathematical, right? That's how it gets onto that list. Our first book was called The Exception to the Rulers. And the reason David and I called it that is because that should be the motto of all the media. The exception to the rulers, exposing oily politicians, war profiteers, and the media that love them. The second was called Static. And the reason we called it that is even in this high-tech digital age with high-definition television and digital radio, still all we get is static. When what we need is the media to give us the dictionary definition of static: criticism, opposition, unwanted interference. We need a media that covers power, not covers for power. We need a media that is the fourth estate, not for the state. and we need a media that covers the movements that create static and make history. Our third book was called Standing Up to the Madness, Ordinary Heroes in Extraordinary Times. Those books I wrote with my brother journalist David Goodman. The next two were the books of our columns. The first of those two, written with Denis, who just came in, is Breaking the Sound Barrier, What We Do Every Day. An incredible journalist. How are we doing on time, Dan? We're doing well. Because I want to get time, by the way, to sit down, sign books. You can come up even if you haven't, if you have something, share a story. Or, by the way, email all story ideas to stories@democracynow.org. Not just today. Whenever something comes up, if you know someone who should be interviewed, if there's something in your community, that's why Democracy Now! Is so rich with original voices. It's people saying, this is what's happening in our community, not the media-appointed leaders who often the people in the community don't even know who they are, or say, that doesn't represent my point of view. But Breaking the Sound Barrier, and the last one we called The Silenced Majority. Let me explain. I really do think that those who care about war and peace, those who care about the growing inequality between rich and poor in this country, between the rich and the rest of us, I mean, think about this. 62 people in the world, 43 of them from the United States, own more wealth than half the world's population, than 3.5 billion people, 43 people, 43 Americans, part of this group of 62, you could fit them on a school bus. And you think in this country of the schools that are being closed, that are being shuttered, kids, the kind of education they get. Would they call it austerity in other countries? We deal with austerity right here at home. I really do think that those who care about war and peace, who care about inequality, who care about climate change, the fate of the planet, are not a fringe minority, not even a silent majority, but the silenced majority, silenced by the corporate media, which is why we have to take it back, build our own media, challenge them. They are using our airwaves. It's not private property. They may be private corporations. They're using the public airwaves. They have a responsibility to bring out all the opinions of people, movements, or have their licenses revoked. And so we have to challenge those that are using the public airwaves and build our own media all over this country. I want to talk about the year 2011, but before I do that, as we go on this tour, Juan Gonzalez is here with me in spirit, co-host of Democracy Now! For the full 20 years. Juan just retired from the New York Daily News, where he's been a columnist for 29 years. It was the biggest city paper in the country. He's very beloved. When he announced his retirement, the mayor, you know, tweeted, and all the big journalists tweeted about Juan. He's going to be a professor at Rutgers, but he's staying with his other DN. That's Democracy Now!, from the Daily News to Democracy Now! But just a few months ago, the whole gang of us at Democracy Now! Went to Midtown Manhattan to honor Juan because he was being inducted into the New York Journalism Hall of Fame, first Latino journalist to be inducted. And I wanted to read you a few words of Juan's, putting the other inductees to shame as he spoke. They were like Charlie Rose and Leslie Stahl. And Juan said, I figured my modest contribution would be not writing about outcast neighborhoods, but from them. Not simply to entertain, but to change. Not after the fact, but before it, when coverage could still make a difference. I've tried to use as many of my columns as possible to probe the injustices visited upon the powerless. Yes, the rich and famous are also victims on occasion. But they have so many politicians, lobbyists, lawyers, gossip columnists, and even editorial writers ready to jump to their defense that they'll always do fine without my help. I prefer the desperate, unknown reader who comes to me because he or she has gone everywhere else and no one will listen. More often than not, I come across the unexpected gems, human beings whose tragedies illuminate the landscape and whose courage hopefully inspires the reader to believe that there is indeed some greater good served by a free press than just chronicling or influencing the ouster of one group of politicians by another. Our book, Democracy Now! Celebrates some of the people and movements who've been making history during our first 20 years. It's not an exhaustive history. It's not meant to be a greatest hits. This book is just our way of giving back by celebrating some of the ordinary heroes who've done extraordinary things to make the world a better place. And just mentioning this year, 2011, arbitrarily taking 1 year. You think about what happened in that year. At the beginning, the Tunisian Revolution at the end of December 2010, sparked by a young man who set himself on fire, Mohamed Bouazizi, because he felt no opportunity and he'd been harassed by the authorities. They took his scales where he weighed vegetables and fruits in the marketplace, couldn't take it anymore. It sparked the Tunisian Revolution. So did WikiLeaks. Because when Assange and WikiLeaks released the documents that showed the U.S. was shoring up the dictator, they knew that they had a corrupt dictator. But they realized the U.S. full well knew it and still shored up this dictator. Tunisia sparked Egypt. Our producer, Sharif Abdelkadous, I can't say enough about, as he flew back to his country. He was Egyptian-American. And Hani Massoud, our videographer, Egyptian-American as well, leaps tall buildings in a single bound. You want him at your side in times of trouble. He played on the Egyptian national basketball team, and they flew into Tahrir, and you got coverage like nowhere else. The networks have much more resources, but we developed this way to send broadcast quality video through the internet, you know, and the thugs knocked down the satellites. Now, we do satellites too now, by the way, all over. But we also know how to do it the other way. So you had Anderson Cooper, sort of the old Democracy Now! Skypey way, with a lower third that said reporting from an undisclosed location in his hotel room. And you had Sharif in the middle of Tahrir saying, I'm here in Tahrir, this is the safest place to be in this country. And Hani would be filming his interviews, and you didn't just get the bird's eye view, which was impressive, a million people in Tahrir that the networks were bringing you, but the satellites had gone down. You got these 25, 30-minute rich series of interviews. You were meeting the people fomenting revolution, people like you all over. You met, Adef Suef, the great Egyptian writer who wrote Map of Love, who was with 2 9-month pregnant women. By the way, it's beautiful to see you here today because our finance director is in labor as we speak. And I'm texting her wildly as we're driving, has Una come yet? Has Una come yet? Just calm down, Amy. I said, you are forbidden to go to work. She has this tendency where she goes to work at times like this, like, I don't know, to alleviate stress. It's hard to believe that that's alleviating stress. I said, you're in labor, but you're not supposed to be laboring with us. She said, okay, I'll stay home. So Adef Suef is with 2 women who are 9 months pregnant, and they say they're not going to deliver their babies until the dictator Mubarak was toppled because she wants them to be born in freedom. You meet Nawal Sadawi, at the time 79-year-old Egyptian writer, psychiatrist, presidential candidate. You've been imprisoned and exiled under Nasser, under Mubarak. And she'd been telling young people, even before Tahrir, we will win, we will win. You met the young high school student who was standing in front of the state media building that had spewed lies for so long, putting out a broadsheet. Voices of Tahrir. This was an amazing revolution that was fomented by community. We don't know where it's going to go today. Egypt is in deep, deep trouble. But what they did then in toppling this dictator was historic. And that inspired, I think, Wisconsin, right here. 150,000 people marching against the governor busting public unions. He was going after the teachers and the nurses. He assured the firefighters and the police, I'm not going after you. He had a problem, though, because the police and the firefighters were married to the teachers and the nurses. And so it seemed like almost everybody rose up. They took over the Capitol building in Madison, and Democracy Now! Flew in. It was amazing. Egyptians were ordering pizza for the Wisconsin protesters online. They were sleeping in the Capitol building. I saw some scenes like students with dreads down their backs, drumming on anything they could find in front of the governor's office with the police rocking out next to them. No, we don't have that in New York. I saw some of the biggest guys I'd ever seen, the Oshkosh prison guards. And I went up to them and I said, who did you vote for? And they said, Governor Walker, of course. And I said, so what are you doing here? They said, protesting Governor Walker, of course. And they said, we didn't know he was going to do this. And I saw this guy outside in the freezing cold, 150,000 people in the snow, older gentleman, white hair, glasses, and he's marching with his placard that says, IRS auditors against Walker. And I said, are you a Republican or a Democrat? And he said, a Republican. So I said, so what are you doing here? He said, I'm protesting the Republican governor, because we didn't know that he was going to try to destroy our community. I said, well, you have a mighty weapon there, IRS auditors against Walker. And if you wonder, well, what difference does it make, right? He was reelected, he then ran for president, Walker. You know, did any of these, if they just flash in a pan, why people waste their time? You could stay home in front of a fire and cozy up with your family. They make an enormous difference. Over time, movements matter. I looked out over the vista of people protesting. There was the Labor Museum in Madison. Go back to 1968, Dr. Martin Luther King, Memphis, Tennessee. He was assassinated April 4th, 68. What was he doing in Memphis? What momentous thing? He'd simply gone to Memphis to stand with sanitation workers. You know, AFSCME was born in Wisconsin, the American Federation of State, County, Municipal Employees. So was the John Birch Society. John Birch Society, co-founded by the Koch brothers' father, Fred Koch, the oil barons, Fred Koch. John Birch Society, racist, segregationist, anti-civil rights organization, went after King and others. AFSCME, John Birch Society, two different tendencies. When King died, he was standing with sanitation workers who were simply trying to organize a local of AFSCME. That was 1968. It was born in 1932 in Wisconsin. And then move forward, summer of 2011, thousands of people march against the Keystone XL in front of the White House, ring around the Rose Garden. 1,200 get arrested, like Naomi Klein, her first arrest, the great writer who wrote The Shock Doctrine, Rise of Disaster Capitalism, and her most recent book, This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate. Bill McKibben, who co-founded 350.org, they all got arrested. A few weeks later, Occupy Wall Street. Thousands stream into Zuccotti Park with every sign under the sun against war, against poverty, against climate change. And the media first ignore them. That's the most powerful thing they can do. As if they don't exist, they vanish. But then they continued there in these encampments, and they couldn't ignore them, so they mocked them. I remember on CNN, the first report of a new show, it said, seriously? You know, every issue under the sun, can't they settle on one? But that was its power. They saw all these issues linked. And where are the leaders? They were a leaderful organization, not leaderless. Some of those people who marched into Occupy Wall Street were carrying signs that said, I am Troy Davis. Troy Davis was on death row in Jackson, Georgia. He was slated to die 4 days later, September 21st. 2011, we raced to Jackson a few days later to cover this execution. If we could have been in the execution chamber, we would have been. I really do think if you see the images, that's where you begin to make a decision about what you want this country to represent. Troy Davis on death row for 20 of the 40 years of his life. So many people had taken up his cause. We describe in the book his case. I'm not going to describe it here. Suffice it to say right now, that there were three death warrants before this one that were all vacated. Didn't know what would happen with this. By the time that he was slated to die, you had the traditional anti-death penalty activists, you had prison wardens, you had a former US president and the Pope all demanding that Troy Anthony Davis be allowed to live. 1,000 people gathered in Jackson at the death row prison. And we just decided we would broadcast that day. And we were handed a press packet from the prison guards, and we read this press packet on the air. It was extremely puzzling what they were focusing on. They focused on what he would be fed for dinner. No, first they gave us his schedule. They said his family would be cleared out at 3 o'clock so he could have a routine physical. Routine physical? You know, right before that, a Texas prisoner on death row had attempted suicide on death row. They raced him to the hospital, got him better, then they executed him. So then the print packet said what he would eat for dinner. They said he would be given grilled cheeseburgers, oven brown potatoes, baked beans, coleslaw, cookies, and a great beverage. Another page listed the four lines of a lethal cocktail that would follow: pentobarbital, pancuronium bromide, potassium chloride, and Ativan, a sedative. The pentobarbital anesthetizes, the pancuronium bromide paralyzes, the potassium chloride stops the heart. Davis refused the sedative and the Last Supper. By 7 p.m., and we were broadcasting now, we didn't know what would happen. We were out on the grounds where 150 people were allowed in a protest pen across the street, 1,000. Students from Morehouse, students from Spelman, the traditionally black colleges, all holding candles. People from around the world, the heads of Amnesty International, the NAACP, the family of Troy Davis. It was an astounding moment. We were the only ones continuously covering this. Our broadcast, we had a satellite truck. Our broadcast was being projected onto St. Mary's Church in Harlem as thousands of people all over the country were trying to access what would happen. Students were gathering around in libraries around the country watching our broadcast on the computer. By 7 p.m., the U.S. Supreme Court was reportedly reviewing Davis's plea for a stay. The case was referred to Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, who hails from Pinpoint, Georgia, a community founded by freed slaves near Savannah. The Supreme Court denied the plea. Davis's execution began at 10:53 p.m. A prison spokesperson delivered the news to the reporters outside. The time of death was 11:08 p.m. The eyewitnesses to the execution stepped out. According to an Associated Press reporter who was there, these were Troy Davis's final words. He said, "I'd like to address the McPhail family, the officer who had been killed, Mark McPhail, a hero cop who had gone to help a homeless man who was being pistol whipped. And he was shot. He didn't even have time to draw his gun." Troy said to the family, you know how an execution works, is that they're put out on a kind of Christ-like cross and they're strapped down to the cross with their arms out and their legs. And then just before the injection begins, curtains are pulled back and the audience views what's happening. You've got the family of the murder victim, you've got the people the prisoner chose to come, if the prison allows that, and you've got the reporters. So the AP reporter said, this is what Troy said. He said, "I'd like to address the McPhail family. Let you know I'm not the one who killed your son, your father, your brother. I am innocent." He said, "The incident that took place that night was not my fault. I didn't have a gun. All I can ask is that you look deeper into this case so that you really can finally see the truth." He said, "I ask my family and friends to continue to fight this fight," and then ended by looking at his executioners and said, "For those about to take my life, God have mercy on your souls. May God bless your souls." The state of Georgia took Davis's body to Atlanta for an autopsy, charging his family for the transportation. On Troy Davis's death certificate, the cause of death is listed simply as homicide. As I stood on the grounds of the prison, just after Troy Davis was executed, the Georgia Department of Corrections threatened to pull the plug on our broadcast. The show was over, and I could only think about what Mahatma Gandhi reportedly answered when asked what he thought of Western civilization. He said, "I think it would be a good idea." That was September 21st, 2011. Move forward, November, you know what happened here in Davis. Students in solidarity with Occupy Wall Street were protesting on the grounds of the campus, and they are hit at point blank range with pepper spray. This story continuing through this day, right, 5 years later. It's agonizing to be hit, to even inhale pepper spray in the vicinity, let alone to be hit at point blank range. Peaceful students doing what responsible citizens in this country, if you want to have a say in your country and you want to do it nonviolently, people engage in the time-honored traditions. Look at Dr. King. Sit-ins, making your voices heard, rallies, and universities should be the incubators of this. teaching people to be responsible citizens, even when the students are protesting their campuses or their administrations. And then the students learning today, as we've reported on Democracy Now!, that afterwards that the university is spending close to $200,000 to erase websites referencing this moment. All of these protests, all of these expressions of we can be better than this together, we can make mistakes, but we can move forward together, are what make this country great. And I want to end with the end of 2011 on the issue of climate change. We cover every UN climate summit, you know, from Copenhagen to Cancun, from Doha to Durban, from Poland to Peru to Paris. We're there in force, the only national broadcast there every day, bringing you the voices of people all over the world who are threatened with extinction. It's amazing what these summits are about. Not so much what doesn't happen inside, but the thousands of people who come to educate the most powerful country on earth, the United States, about what we are doing that threatens them, because we're historically the largest greenhouse gas emitter. The United States, China, must be held responsible here. And I wanted to end with the words of a young activist who was invited to address the world body representing the youth. Her name was Anjali Appadurai. And then me, Denis, and David, whoops, then David, Denis, and I, we've written a book after all. Oh, we'll go outside and sign books. It's so gorgeous outside. And look forward to meeting you. Anjali's invited to the stage, and she looks out on the thousands of her elders, the delegates, the scientists, the diplomats. And she says, I speak for more than half the world's population. We are the silent majority. You've given us a seat in this hall, but our interests are not on the table. What does it take to get a stake in this game? Lobbyists, corporate influence, money? You have been negotiating all of my life. You failed to meet pledges. You've missed targets. But you've heard this all before. We're in Africa, home to communities on the front line of climate change. The science tells us we have 5 years max. You say, give us 10. The starkest betrayal of your generation's responsibility to ours is that you call this ambition. Where is the courage in these rooms? Now is not the time for incremental action. In the long run, these will be seen as the defining moments of an era in which narrow self-interest prevailed over science, reason, and common compassion. She said, stand with Africa. There is real ambition in this room, but it's been dismissed as radical, deemed not politically possible. Long-term thinking is not radical. What's radical is to completely alter the planet's climate, to betray the future of my generation, and to condemn millions to death by climate change. What's radical is to write off the fact that change is within our reach. 2011 was the year in which the silent majority found their voice, the year when the bottom shook the top. 2011 was the year when the radical became reality. She ended by quoting Nelson Mandela, who said, it always seems impossible until it's done. So, distinguished delegates, this college student said to the masses of her elders, so distinguished delegates and governments around the world, governments of the developed world, deep cuts now. Get it done. Democracy Now!
And get a complimentary DVD. Thank you again for coming and supporting Community Radio and Democracy Now!'s 20th anniversary. And thank you to all the businesses and people that helped make this possible. And have a great Sunday.